morning, everyone, and thank you very much. Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
And welcome to worship here at the United Benefice of St. Aidan and St. Luke, St. Mark and St. Philip in Blackburn for the second Sunday of Easter. And we hope that everyone's had a really good week. But I do just wonder how many of you have got any chocolate Easter egg left to eat? Any chocolate Easter egg? Oh, well done. Some people haven't had them all in one go. We like a bit of sunshine, but I do apologise if today it makes the screen a little bit hard to see. And welcome to everyone joining us on social media as well. I'm the Reverend Cath Brooks, and I'll be leading you through today's service, including words coming up on the screen. If you're wondering where the Reverend Barbara is, she's having a well-deserved post-Easter break. And just a reminder that we are conducting our act of worship within the COVID-19 guidelines, which means that we can't join in with the singing. Easter is a season and not just a day. And that's why we're continuing to use the Easter greeting of Alleluia, Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Alleluia. And the praise of our risen Lord continues as we listen to our first hymn. Jesus is Lord, creation's voice proclaims it.
Thank you.
Some words of introduction. The gospel calls us to turn away from sin and be faithful to Christ. As we offer ourselves to Him in penitence and in faith, we renew our confidence and trust in His mercy. And some words of confession will come up on the screen for us all to say together. Most merciful God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, we confess that we have sinned in thought, word, and deed. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbours as ourselves. In your mercy, forgive what we have been. Help us to amend what we are and direct what we shall be, that we may do justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with you, our Lord. Amen. And we are assured of God's forgiveness. May the Father of all mercies cleanse you from your sins and restore you in His image, to the praise and glory of His name, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Today's theme is, You Are Not Alone, and our readings are from Acts chapter 4, verses 32 to 35. Psalm 133. The first letter of John, chapter 1, verse 1, through to chapter 2, verse 2, and John's Gospel, chapter 20, verses 19 to 13. And I'm going to read from Acts and John's Gospel. First of all, Acts. All the believers were one in heart and mind. No one claimed that any of their possessions was their own, but shared everything they had. With great power, the apostles continued to testify to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus. And God's grace was so powerfully at work in them all, that there was no needy person among them. For from time to time, those who owned land or houses sold them, and they brought the money from those sales and laid them at the disciples' feet. And it was distributed to everyone who had a need. And now, John's Gospel, chapter 20, starting at verse 19. On the evening of that first day of the week, when the disciples were together, with the doors locked for fear of the Jewish leaders, Jesus came and stood among them and said, Peace be with you. After Jesus had said this, he showed them his hands and side. The disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. Again Jesus said, Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, I am sending you. And with that he breathed on them and said, Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive anyone's sins, their sins are forgiven. If you do not forgive them, they are not forgiven. Now Thomas, also known as Didymus, one of the 12, was not with the disciples when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But Thomas said to them, "Unless I see the nail marks in his hands, and put my finger where the nails were, and put my hand into his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were in the house again, and Thomas was with them. Though the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here. See my hands. Reach out your hand and put it into my side. Stop doubting and believing." Thomas said to him, "My Lord and my God." Then Jesus told him, "Because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed." Jesus performed many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not recorded in this book. But these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. And today I'm framing my thought around the following points. Why is it important not to be an isolated Christian? How does the description of the early church in the Acts reading make you feel? And what does the John reading say about belief? Today I'm starting by taking us back to the beginning of the Bible. There we find two accounts of creation. If I ask people what the Bible says about creation, most would probably focus on the first account, which touches on the creation of different aspects of the universe, culminating with the creation of human beings. However, the second account has a different emphasis. There's a much greater emphasis on human companionship. Humans were not meant to be isolated. I think that one of the long-term legacies of the various lockdowns we've endured over the past year is the ongoing impact that the isolation will have on our health. And this applies to all age groups. We may well have been given the impression previously that young people wanting to isolate themselves in their bedrooms and be left alone and only have virtual contact with other people. But over recent months, it's become abundantly clear that this isn't the case. One of the important things which the passages I just read highlight is the fellowship of Christian believers. The oneness of heart and mind, unity of purpose in spreading the good news of the risen Jesus, support for each other, and working together. to suit every Christian. And over time, how the church expresses its fellowship and worship has developed. In our Acts reading, we are given a picture of how the early church worked. And as I read this passage, I wonder what your thoughts were. They probably ranged from "they'd got it right" through to "idealistic dreamers" and covered everything in between. When I was at university, I knew someone who joined one of the early modern day house churches, and this was modelled on the fellowship pattern we've just heard about in the early church. After a few years, they left and joined a more mainstream church. They still agreed with the principles of that house church, that God created everyone to be equal and to look out for each other at all times. The difficulty was that human interest had got in the way. People were watching how much others were contributing. Some high earners left their jobs because they thought they were subsidizing others. And people began to judge what they considered was need. Yet, does that all mean that the house church had got it wrong? Or does it merely highlight human frailties? I mentioned the creation story at the start, which reminds us of God's unlimited generosity to us, and that extends to all areas of our life and our relationship with God. The ultimate expression of this generosity is the reason for the Easter season. Jesus dying and rising so that we can have that new start with God. That's the basis of Christian faith. It's what we as Christians believe. And Thomas's response to the risen Jesus reminds us of the difference between belief and proof. I sometimes wonder how he didn't spot the difference in his fellow disciples after they'd seen the risen Jesus. Surely there'd be an excitement which couldn't be put on, and which was so different from their previous gloom and despondency. However, God graciously gave Thomas the proof he wanted. But he also gives us wonderful words of encouragement at the same time. Those words that say, "Blessed are those who have not seen, and yet have believed." I suspect that at some time, every Christian has had some form of doubt about their faith. But the important thing to remember is we are not alone. God is there to help us through those times of doubt, and importantly, so are our fellow Christians, who are there to provide fellowship support and to build us up and build each other up in our faith and belief. And that's what leads us into our key verse for today. the first verse in Psalm 133, which says, "How good and pleasant it is when God's people live together in unity." And we'll just spend a few moments silence thinking on those words. The words of our next hymn pick up on our unity in Jesus as we listen to "The Spirit Lives to Set Us Free." Grant ask God to increase our faith and belief. We heard in our reading that Thomas was slow to believe, and that it was only when he saw the risen Lord that he believed. We thank you, Lord, for those special times when each one of us has had our faith built up by you. We give thanks also for our fellow Christians who have supported us when we have had times of doubt about our faith. We ask you, loving Lord, to increase and deepen our faith and trust in you. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Next, we pray for the worldwide church. Gracious Lord, we give thanks for everyone who believes in you and who puts their trust in you. We pray for the ongoing unity of the worldwide church, that it may faithfully witness to your resurrection. May the church rejoice in the presence of your life-giving Spirit. We think of Christians who have become isolated or who are being persecuted for their faith, and we ask that you give them a special touch of your presence, and that they are aware of your ongoing love surrounding them at all times. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We now pray for people who are in need. Ever caring God, we bring to you all who are in need of any kind. We think of the lonely, especially anyone who has become isolated in the past year, and we pray that contact with their friends and support groups is re-established. We ask that your healing presence is known to all who are ill at this time, whether it's with a long-term illness or COVID-19 and its after effects, or maybe the result of an accident or a seasonal illness. You, Lord, know everyone's needs, and we ask that you will be blessing these people. And we pause for a moment to name in the quiet of our hearts those who we know personally who need your healing touch. We also remember the recently bereaved, and we give thanks for the lives of their loved ones. At this time, the nation's thoughts are with the royal family, as we give thanks for the Duke of Edinburgh and his lifetime of service. We ask that you surround all who are grieving the loss of a loved one with your comfort and your compassion. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And we now say the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive them that trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, between James Christopher Ashley, single, of the parish of St. Michael and All Angels, Cottingley, and Rachel Michelle White, single, of the parish of St. Michael and All Angels, Cottingley, and with a qualifying connection to St. Aidan Blackburn. This is for the third time of reading. If any of you know in a reason in law why these persons may not marry each other, you should declare it now. Rachel and Jim will be very pleased that their wedding can go ahead next Saturday, and we now say a prayer for them. Dear Lord, we ask that you will continue to bless Rachel and Jim in these coming few days just prior to their wedding day. We ask that any final arrangements which need to be sorted out will be made without any problems, and that it is a truly joyful day for Rachel and Jim, their families and friends. Amen. I now come to the notices, and tomorrow from 9 o'clock I'll be taking bookings for the next 2 weeks. That's the 18th and 25th of April. I do hope that everyone has a good week, and do please continue to take care. And just a reminder that we are still following the advice relating to social distancing and grouping as we leave church and the grounds. Our final blessing. May you find in the risen Lord the way to fullness of life, and the way to joy and peace. And the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you all today and ever.